Wayne's thoughts. Deep thoughts by Wayne Carver. Remember Jack Hanner. Okay, never mind.
Y'all depend on where you are in the sovereignty of God. How much control does he have?
Total.
So we sing a song, Lord, take control, right? Do we really mean that? Do we really mean, Lord, take control of my life?
We should, yeah.
Because I will surely wreck it.
Yes.
I think what scares us about that is we might end up in a fish or something.
That's right.
Oh, well. Okay. So...
Gary, just a quick thought on that is a few years ago, I think we were with the Bible group and we were talking about, hey, we should pray, you know, if our end goal is we want to get to heaven, we should make sure we pray that God does what he needs to do in our lives to get us to heaven.
Right.
That's a scary thing to pray for. if you think about, man, what if life is going good and if I feel like, you know, I'm in control, and maybe I don't need God as much as other people do, and things are going just fine. But, you know, what's the status of your spiritual life? And if you pray to get you to heaven, watch out.
Yeah, yeah. I agree. It can be a scary thing to pray for these things, like kind of like praying for patience, right? We're always leery of doing that.
Yeah, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Remember, we pray for patience and all saving the brethren. I'm just kidding. That's playing. So, it's tempting for Christians today to believe that God worked in the past and that he will work in the future at the end of time. But many today question whether God is really working in our present time. You know, we can see he worked in the past. We can read Revelation, see people work in the future. Some question, is he working right here, right now? But the entire Bible assumes that God is constantly at work in the world which he created. Prophet Amos sees God working in the past. Amos sees him working in the present. And Amos sees him working in the future. God worked for Israel in the past. Amos 2, verse 10, I brought you up out of Egypt and led you 40 years in the wilderness to give you the land of the Amorites. And then he says, Amos talks about in chapter 9, verse 1, about him intervening in the future. He says, strike the tops of the pillars so that the threshold shake. Bring them down on the head of all the people. Those who are left I will kill with the sword. No one will get away. None will escape. Amos also announces to the people what God is doing in their present day. So see, he covers all three here. In chapter 5, verse 12, for I know how many are your offenses and how great your sins. Chapter 7, verse 8, I'm setting a plumb line among my people Israel. Still working with them the whole time. Chapter 4, verse 13, God continues to work in his own creation. It says, he who forms the mountains, who creates the wind, and who reveals his thoughts to mankind, who turns dawn to darkness and treads on the heights of the earth, the Lord God Almighty is his name. So, the God who worked in the past and who will work at the end of time is also constantly at work in the here and now, right?
Right.
Do you really believe that?
Yes.
Yes. I hope you do. Let's look at it closer. So, the first two chapters of the book of Genesis, well, was Adam and Eve, were they Jews?
No.
They weren't?
They didn't exist at the time.
Jews didn't exist? Just so one day God said, boom, Jews.
Descendants of Abraham. That was the promise to Abraham. The Jews were the promise, were the fulfillment of the promise to Abraham.
Hmm. So Adam and Eve were not Jews.
Prove me wrong.
So they were Gentiles.
They were Gardenites.
I like it.
Yeah,
I was on the
cavemen.
Gardonians.
Okay. So we have four elders in here, so surely they will know if they were Jews, Gentiles, or
Urbanites.
Maybe Klingons. I am so grateful not to be an elder if that's the conversation.
I'm praying for the lies being told.
Okay.
Well, after 14 hours, you had to find something to talk about.
Wow. That hurts thinking about that. Okay. So, first two chapters of the book of Genesis do not teach originally God created an Israelite, but rather God created all humanity and in his own image. It's illogical to believe that God is responsible for the existence of all humanity, but that he is concerned with only one group of people. Do I hear what I just said?
Yes.
It's illogical to believe that God is responsible for all of humanity, but he's only concerned with only one group of people. So many Israelites, like the prophet Jonah, may have believed that God's love was limited to them only. Remember Jonah studied about him? But God's messengers in the Old Testament taught that God loves and wishes to redeem all nations. You know, I mean, our Jewish friends, still, you want to become a Jew, as far as, you know, religion, theologically, you might or might not be able to. I mean, you have to go through a lot of stuff to become Jewish, and then they're likely to say, no, you can't be Jewish. Because for some of you, they look at it as, you know, God's chosen people, we're the only ones. You cannot join our club, Wayne. You will not be Jewish like Sammy Davis Jr. Okay? Take that. So, Psalm 96, well, yeah, Psalm 96, 31, 32. Envoys will come from Egypt, Cush, Ethiopia, will submit herself to God. Sing to God, you kingdoms of the earth. Sing praises to the Lord. It's all the kingdoms here. Isaiah 19:25. The Lord Almighty will bless them, saying, blessed be Egypt, my people. Assyria, my handiwork, and Israel, my inheritance. Everybody, right? That's what Amos is saying. God's good and all of them. So though Amos preached to northern Israel, he announced that God is a universal God who cares for and he loves all nations. Amos 9, verse 7, are not the Israelites the same to me as the Cushites, declares the Lord? Did I not bring Israel up from Egypt, the Philistines from Kaphtor, and the Arameans from Kir? So the same God who manifested his love to Israel also manifested his love to the Ethiopians, the Philistines, and the Syrians. Okay. So because God loves all nations, he sent his prophets to warn them of the destruction which was coming because of their sins. One of the most instructive books of the Old Testament, Jonah, that we've studied, in which God sends a prophet to warn Nineveh. God employs Israel as an object lesson to other nations. Amos 3, verse 9, proclaim to the fortresses of Ashdod, to the fortresses of Egypt, assemble yourselves on the mountains of Samaria, see the great unrest within her and the oppression among her people. Amos summons Assyria and Egypt to come to Israel in order to see that God was punishing a nation for their sins. You know, I mean, there's an elephant in the room that say, well, you know, is God punishing the United States for our sins at present? Have we turned our back so far from God? God says, okay, I'll let you do that. In this way, the nations could learn that God exacts judgment against those who ignore him. Amos 1 and verse 3 through chapter 2, verse 4 contains a series of oracles against foreign nations. Syria, Philistia, Phoenicia, Ammon, and Moab. Then they're followed by oracles against Judah and Israel. They have the same general tone and theme indicating that God shows no partiality to one nation over another, but is equally concerned with all of them. Amos' words also indicates that God puts his people on the same level as the surrounding nations and offers them no special dispensation from accountability. Is this foreign to any of you hearing this? that you have Israel, Judah, but God is telling them, basically, look, I love all these people. It ain't just you. That's what he's saying. And my judgment can come on them, and you as well. So God and Israel. Each oracle here against the nations is introduced in the same way with the phrase, for three sins, even four, I will not relent. This repeated phrase is the Lord's way of communicating for transgressions too numerous to count. So, I have this map here. Chapter 1, verse 3 of Amos. For three sins of Damascus, Syria, you see up there in upper right, even before I will not relent because of, she threshed Gilead with sledges having iron teeth. Whatever that means. I didn't go into that. I was too excited about Mops's ear being put back on. Or not. For three sins of Gaza, Philistia, even down here in the lower left, I will not relent because she took captive whole communities and sold them to Edom. Chapter 1, verse 9, for three sins of Tyre, Phoenicia, even for four, I will not relent because she sold whole communities of captives to Edom, disregarding the treaty of brotherhood. And what you'll see is, it's going all the way around. You have Tyre, Syria, Ammon, Moab, Edom, and Gaza. What is their difference from Israel and Judah? Israel and Judah were...
Israel and Judah are capitalized.
Yeah, that's what I was looking for. So to the elders, I hereby resign my position. Okay, so we see them coming around. Ammon, and you can read that in your Bibles for yourself there in chapter 1, part 2 as well. Ammon, Moab, and then it's down to Judah. Three sins of Judah, even before I will not relent, because they rejected the law of the Lord, not kept his decrees, because they've been led astray by false gods, the gods their ancestors followed. And then he ends up with Israel. For three sins of Israel, even before I will not relent, they sell the innocent for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals. They trample on the heads of the poor as on the dust of the ground and deny justice to the oppressed. Father and son use the same girl, so profane my holy name. They lie down beside every altar on garments taken in pledge. In the house of their God, they drink wine taken as fines. The foreign nations were guilty of terrible violence, cruelty, inhumanities against others. The foreign nations, meaning Tyre, Syria, Ammon, Moab, Edom, Gaza, the foreign nations were guilty of these things. But you know what? So was Israel and Judah. Judah was guilty of idolatry, violation of the law. Israel abused the poor, denied justice to those who needed the most. And a sin is no less serious just because God's people commit it. You follow that? A sin is no less serious just because God's people commit it. It's just as wrong for Israel to mistreat the poor as it is for these foreign nations to be cruel. This was kind of news to all of them. We're God's people. Okay, and stop being ugly. Act right. That's what Amos, the prophet here, is telling them. You got to straighten up, man. All of you. God's bringing judgment. So according to Amos, Israel and Judah were even more guilty than others because they had greater opportunities than foreign nations, but ignored these opportunities. Amos teaches that God chose Israel to be his own people and share a special relationship with him. And it's this distinct relationship itself kind of held them to a higher standard. Chapter 3, by Amos verses 1 and 2. Hear this word, people of Israel. The word of the Lord is spoken against you, against the whole family I brought up out of Egypt. You only have I chosen of all the families of the earth. Therefore, I will punish you for all your sins. I think the message he's getting across here is pretty clear. The greater the privilege, the greater the responsibility. And then Jesus himself offered the same announcement in Luke chapter 12, verse 48. He says, this is Jesus. From everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded. And from the one who has been entrusted with much, much more will be asked. Israel had received much from the Lord, but they had responded with indifference and ingratitude. Oh yeah, we deserve all this. We deserve it, God. You owe us this. So, years ago, and y'all probably hear this in a sermon sometime, because I'll use this illustration again. I was a young airman here at Eglin, and, it's like 19, 20 years old, and was dating this little sweet thing over in Niceville. Later on, I met Rhonda. Oh, y'all know that's my sweet thing. So anyway, I played on our squadron football team, flag football team. And we did really well, and we got all the way to the playoffs, and we went through that, and we were playing for the championship for the base. I was in the communications squadron at Eglin. And we got there, and we were practicing all, and we all got in a huddle down in the end zone for the kickoff and all. And our coach was one of the guys I worked with. I was an airman first class. He was a tech sergeant. I mean, I had two stripes, and he had five. Had to think of five. He had five. Tech sergeant. Now, airman first class had to back. This is
back.
Back when you were in, it might have had three. It's got two now. Different eras, bro. Don't sidetrack me. Anyway, so here we were. We all got in the huddle. And he said, all right, let's come get us pray. And I said, oh, good, we'll pray. We all got together. We put our hand in. And he started praying to God for us to win. And he said, God, you owe me this championship. You owe me this. I started to bring my hand back. I said, we're going to die and go straight to hell. Right here. Right here. I said, we're going to get hit by lightning. And I said, we lost bad. We lost that game bad. And I know it had to be because of that prayer. Because God owed us. Even God owed me. I said, do you believe this clown saying this? Lord, you owe me this. Woo! Oh, man. I'll never forget that story. And I'll probably tell it again, so y'all heard it here first. Or have I told it? I don't think I told it. I'm getting old. I can't remember stories I tell. So, here they were. Sorry. I get myself sidetracked sometimes. Israel had received much from the Lord, but they were indifferent. Chapter 2, 11 and 12. I brought you up out of Egypt, led you 40 years in the wilderness to give you the land of the Amorites. I raised up prophets from among your children and Nazarites from among your youth. Is this not true, people of Israel, declares the Lord? But you made the Nazarites drink wine and commanded the prophets not to prophesy. Remember the Nazarites? They couldn't drink wine, right? Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Agree with me, David. No nation had any greater advantages than Israel, yet they misused God's gifts, took them for granted, and assumed they were deserved. Romans 9, 4, 5, Apostle Paul refers to these same unique advantages. Theirs is the adoption to sonship. Theirs with the divine glory. The covenants, the receiving of the law, the temple worship, the promises. Theirs are the patriarchs, and from them is traced the human ancestry of the Messiah. Such advantages, though, only led to boasting and complacency. Jeremiah 7 and 4, this is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. Jeremiah 7 and 10, we are safe. Very complacent. So all of these advantages will not save Israel because judgment is coming. A statement from the prophet Jeremiah highlights Israel's delusion. God's response to Jeremiah 9:25-26, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will punish all who are circumcised only in the flesh. Egypt, Judah, Edom, Ammon, Moab, and all who live in the wilderness in distant places. For all these nations are really uncircumcised, and even the whole house of Israel is uncircumcised in heart. So though Israel then could boast that they'd been circumcised as the law commanded, they were no better than the nations because, you know, they were uncircumcised in their heart. These people had heart problems. Bad heart problems. Wow, do we see that in our nation today? Do we see heart issues going on? Apostle Paul emphasized the same theme, Romans 2:28-29. A person is not a Jew who is one only outwardly, nor is circumcision merely outward and physical. No, a person is a Jew who is one inwardly. Circumcision is circumcision of the heart, by the Spirit, not by the written code. You know, even though they had all of their feasts and Passover and all this stuff and celebrations, and they would do these things and go to the temple or wherever, God still wanted their heart. That is not a new thing with the New Testament. God always wanted their hearts, our hearts, everyone's hearts. Not just to go through the motions. And we discussed this last week, not just to come here for rites and traditions of the Lord's Supper. And we got to sing a few songs. We got prayer. Open prayer and closing prayer. Put everything in between. And wrap it all up real nice with a bow and send it on to God. Do that every week. God still wants our heart. He knows where our hearts are. Just like back then, he knew exactly where their hearts were. Because Israel has shown indifference and ingratitude to God's high calling, God's word and presence will be removed from their land. Amos 8:11-12, days are coming, declares the sovereign Lord, when I will send a famine through the land, not a famine of food or thirst for water, but a famine of hearing the words of the Lord. People will stagger from sea to sea and wander from north to east, searching for the word of the Lord, but they will not find it. Yeah, God's going to send that famine. He's going to stop talking to them. Israel's going to search for the message of the Lord, but it's going to be a little too late. Because of their sins and their unresponsiveness to his will, God will use a foreign nation, which was Assyria, to overrun his people and carry them into captivity. Chapter 3, verse 1 of Amos, an enemy will overrun your land, pull down your strongholds, and plunder your fortresses. And in chapter 9, 9 and 10, for I will give the command, I will shake the people of Israel among all the nations. As grain is shaken in a sieve, and not a pebble will reach the ground. All the sinners among my people will die by the sword. All those who say disaster will not overtake us. I tell you, you just can't read this book of Amos without thinking of, to me, present day America. It's tempting for powerful nations and kingdoms to feel that they have affairs of state completely under their control. Proverbs 19:21. According to Scripture, God is the real sovereign one who rules all that happens to carry out his purposes. It says many are the plans of a person's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. So, it's the Lord's purpose that prevails. Way back then, in the future, and in the present day, God is still at work in our lives today. God is still at work in our nation today. God is still at work in our church here at Destin. Today. Do you believe that?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Absolutely. Okay, so that is all on Amos. Let's go to the next slide. I got this, actually, I was searching around on Google. This is from the NIV Quick Read Bible that basically gives a broad outline of Amos. Wealth and success can lead to spiritual complacency. Sexual immorality, violence, corruption, and idolatry draw hearts away from God. Then God punishes those who exploit poor people and prosper at their expense. God calls his people lives of justice. But what I want you to get is, it does not end there. It doesn't end with that fourth bubble. God calls his people lives of justice. That doesn't end. Let's look at the fifth bubble. God promises to restore his people after judgment. That's great. That's great news right there. That's what we're reading in Amos. God promises to restore them. You're going to get punished. And you brought it on yourself, right? Yeah. You're going to be punished. Here's what's coming. I will restore you. That's God's lesson to us today.
What good story would, of redemption. What good would punishment be if you couldn't be restored? You know?
Some people, I mean, go to prison for life, I would say their punishment is till they die.
But is that the end?
Their earthly life.
I know people in prison that are there for life that have changed.
Oh, yeah, I do too. And I'm not saying they can't, but their punishment's still there. They're not getting out of jail alive. But, you know, what if a prisoner is in prison for life and he dies of a heart attack, but they bring him back? I think there's an argument. If I did die, I was here for life, but y'all brought me back so I can go free. That's just... I'm sorry. That's totally... Let's get back to this. So God promises to restore, and that's the promise to us today, his people after judgment. I tell you, there's part of me that in praying for our nation, praying for people to turn to God. I feel like a lot of our nation has turned away from God. And we started believing in our military might and our wealth and our privilege. And we turned away from God. And maybe we are going through judgment. Now, I don't know. I'm not saying that we are. I don't know. But God is still in the same place he's always been. And he's still a God of mercy, a God of redemption. Anyway, that's all I have. Any questions on our lesson today? I'm getting us out of here before the bell rang. Unless y'all have questions. Yes, sir. Should take out 15 and help. I mean, you and
Wayne. Just really one short statement from our history class was that even though it feels like there's punishment, God still uses ungodly people as his tools. He can use anyone. His plan. We saw some amazing things through the Roman Empire, through all the things that happened in Europe before we got to here, through the oppression of America before, and the oppression of the slave. All of this, there was a lot of amazing things that happened to God's plan as a result of people that God used, and their faith was irrelevant. God's plan will prevail.
Absolutely.
Well, they're still his people, you know. Yep. They just fall in sin. So God is still, you know, in control, even if they feel like he's not.
Absolutely.
So he still uses them, even without them knowing, to his benefit, to make them.
Yep.
You know, the thing I have trouble with is, with Amos talking about all these other nations that weren't part of Israel or Judah, and the fact that he loved these nations and wanted them to, you know, do right as well. Why do you think, for instance, why did Peter have such a hard time going to the Gentiles at first? He had to have that vision in order to realize that God wanted him to go to the Gentiles in Acts 10, I believe. But once he had that vision, he went to them and realized, you know, God wants me to come to you guys as well. But why do you think it was so hard for them to accept that at first? It was like their law had taught them. I think he even says, the law says we're not supposed to associate with Gentiles. So why did they not know that? Or why did they even think that to begin with?
The Jewish law said they weren't supposed to associate.
Well, that's what he said in Acts 10. He says, I don't remember exactly where, but and he says that our law has taught us not to associate with Gentiles. And so I just wonder where he even got that.
Well, there was a lot to the law that wasn't of God.
Absolutely. Yeah, they may have added that. It could have been something
they have, because in God's message is he loves us all, Jew or Gentile.
Yeah.
And always has. It's not something new, as a lot of people think.
Yeah, it's in
the New Testament.
Acts 10:28, he says, he said to them, "You are well aware that it is against our law for a Jew to associate with or visit a Gentile, but God has shown me that I should not call anyone impure or unclean."
It was their laws that they had there. I mean, it's like Jesus smeared a woman. She said, "Why are you even talking to me?" That wasn't Jewish law that God gave, that he couldn't talk to a woman from Samaria. It was just not something that they did.
Yeah,
you answered it at the end. God was saying you're not supposed to call anyone unpure or unclean. Right. That's what the Lord was saying. And so they were praying the Gentiles, but that's not what the Lord was saying. He said the part of the end there.
So. Right. So they had been misled by maybe their tradition.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
a lot of Jewish traditions. There's a lot of our traditions. We've had some terrible traditions.
Even within
the churches of Christ. Terrible.
If you look back through the law, there was a need for proselytizing in the law. There was a method for bringing people to God in the Old Testament era. And the Jews, the leader of the Jews, whoever it was, sought power and said, "No, we're making this exclusive." And they went another direction. There's a lot of things. I mean, I don't know if you were there for that class we talked about. There were several things that God said, and they go in that direction. God's mercy said, "Okay, for now."
Okay. Any other last thoughts before we close up? Anything profound? Anything non-profound? All right. Well, y'all have a great week. I'll see you in 2 weeks. I'll still be around the building. I'll be here Tuesday and Wednesday or Thursday. If anybody still wants to come see me or talk to me, I changed up the my little paragraph in the bulletin. I've been able to get out and meet with a lot of you and have coffee or lunch or different things like that. It's been great. Still have some lined up. And if you'd like that sometime, love to visit with you. So, but I'll be around this week. John got the class next week. Todd preaching next week, and then I'll keep only going for the weekend. We're on Friday, come back on Monday. So we'll see y'all in 2 weeks as far as the church. All right.
Son is coming to visit.
All right. As you were, go and study up on Malchus and his ear. Lend me your ears.